On the wall, Belshazzar sobered up from his drunken state real quickly, and he called for the soothsayers and the astrologers of Babylon. But none of them could interpret what the writing on the wall had said. Finally, the queen came up to Belshazzar, and she said, "There is someone in this land that can tell us what those words upon that wall mean, and his name is Daniel." The Bible tells us that within Daniel, an excellent spirit was within him. May the Lord be able to say that about us, amen, that an excellent spirit is within us, amen. Well, she said, "Daniel's a holy man, and he will give us the interpretation of what's upon the wall." Well, Daniel 5, 25 through 28 said, and this is the writing that was written. Many, many tekel, Euphrates. This is the interpretation of the thing. Many, God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Praise thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persian. You see, God was saying through the mouth of Daniel, Belshazzar, because of your pride and your arrogance, your time is up. You are being weighed in the balances tonight, and you're not measuring up because of your foolish pride. Tonight, your kingdom will be divided. The scripture goes on to say in Daniel 5 and 30, in that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain. Amen. You see, if Belshazzar was here tonight, he would say, Christians, New Hope Church, don't ever allow a spirit of pride to get a hold of you, because it is awful. You see, it was never God's intention for Belshazzar's life to end so suddenly and quickly, but pride took him to a premature grave. That's why the Bible tells us in Hebrews 10:31, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Amen. Galatians 6 and verse number 7, it says, be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Belshazzar's pride guaranteed his judgment. And the same thing is true in our generation today. Pride still goes before destruction. What man said is sin. I don't need God anymore. You know what that is? That's pride. Man says, I don't need the Bible anymore. It's nothing more than a spirit of pride. I can make the way. I can make it to heaven on my own. But it's a spirit of pride. I don't need God. I don't need his commandment. I don't need his word. I don't need prayer. I don't need his church. I don't need his spirit. It all stems from the same sin called pride. Can you say amen? And you can be sure that whenever pride gets a hold of that heart, if it's not repented of, destruction is soon to come. Can you say amen? So Belshazzar, he tell you, I was lifted up in pride. I was so prideful. I said, get those sacred vessels. Bring them on out. Let's have a party with those. Let's just defy this God that we don't even believe in. But that night a hand came and appeared in their midst. They began to write, tekel, tekel. Amen. Oh, I'm telling you, church, don't let the spirit of pride get a hold of you. You say, Brother Wayne, why are you preaching to us like this tonight? Because pride is no respecter of persons. Amen. I've known many a good people all my life. They were saved. They were sanctified. Some of them filled with the Holy Ghost. But I'll tell you, a spirit of pride got about them. And then they went from being something to nothing. Amen. The Bible tells us in Galatians 6 and 3, if a man thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives his own self. He don't fool nobody else. She don't fool nobody else but themselves. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Pride. During the 40s, 50s, there, I like to do a lot of reading and stuff and just history about old tent revivals. You know, this is when God just really moved. He moves now, but you know what I'm talking about. When God was moving through evangelists with tent revivals and people like A.A. Allen and Jack Cole and just all them real old guys, amen, way before my time. But I remember I was listening to one message by Brother A.A. Allen. It was called God is a Killer, amen. When I heard the title of that, my knees began to buckle like Belshazzar, amen. Oh, but I'm telling you, he got lifted up in pride. Brother Allen did. He sure did. Well, I'm sure if he was here tonight, he'd tell you, don't be lifted up in pride. He got to a place where he said, come on out to the biggest tent in the nation. Come on out to my tent where miracles were happening. Oh, I'm telling you, it may have been subtle, but it started to grow. Amen. I can't tell you how many pastors I know. Oh, it started out so small, but they got lifted up in their pride. And before long, destruction came. In the 1980s, we saw it, didn't we? Or you saw it. I was just 3 years old, born in 87. I was. Amen. Oh, but let me tell you, there was a lot of ministries within the 1980s that fell. Many of them fell, all because they were stemmed to something called pride. One particular preacher said, it's my ministry that gives the most money to missions and the Assemblies of God. My ministry gives more than anybody else. But it wasn't too long after that, God brought them down. Amen. You see, you cannot mock God. You cannot play games with God, because what you sow is what you reap. Can you say amen? Pride still goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Amen. Number two, I want to tell you that if King Saul was here tonight, he'd tell you about the awfulness of pride. Can you say amen? We remember King Saul, don't we? Amen. King Saul would say, I used to be a very humble and meek man. Amen. He sure was. King Saul was so humble that whenever he was to be announced as king, he couldn't even be found. Amen. He was hiding. He was fearful, shy. We see this in 1 Samuel 10 and 21. But Saul would say to you tonight, God anointed me to be the first king of Israel, but the awfulness of pride got the best of me. Amen. In 1 Samuel 15, we read of how King Saul was to utterly destroy, or to completely destroy, the Amalekites. Everything that they had, he was to completely demolish it. But his pride got the best of him. King Saul spared the best of the livestock. He gathered the gold and even spared their king. When Samuel the prophet arrived, he arrived with the message, Saul, you have disobeyed God. It was Saul's pride that led him to a place where he thought, I can act independently from the word of God. And whenever a Christian reaches that place where they no longer need to depend upon God for direction, that person is in trouble and headed for disaster. Can you say amen? When a Christian no longer needs to pray, mark it down, pride is set in that heart. Samuel said to King Saul in 1 Samuel 15, 23, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness, amen, as is iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected thee from being king. What was it that got King Saul not being chosen by God any longer? It was because he got lifted up in pride. He said, I can rule the Israelites without God. Let me tell you, church, we can't do anything without God. Can you say amen? Shame on me as a pastor if I ever get to the place where I say I can do it on my own. I can do it without God. You know, mark it down, church. If I ever get to that place, you can mark it down. There is a fall that will come. Can you say amen? We've got to be humble. Amen. I said, we've got to be humble. Amen. We ain't anything except for the grace of God. Amen. Hallelujah. When the awfulness of pride got a hold of King Saul, God could no longer use him. Pride automatically disqualifies a person from being able to be used by God. Amen. The Bible says that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Amen. Lord, make me humble. Can you say amen? When pride gets a hold of a minister, a teacher, an evangelist, a church member, a Christian, anyone, God can no longer use them unless that pride has been repented of. Can you say amen? After God rejected Saul as king because of pride, it wasn't too much later that God had another young man that he was going to set upon that throne to be the king of Israel. Anybody know his name? David. Amen. And we all know what happened. There was a giant in the land everyone was afraid of. Heard about this from Sunday school, didn't we? Oh, and David killed that giant named Goliath. Then all the women started doing something, and it upset King Saul. 1 Samuel 18, 7 through 9. And the women say it's the woman's fault. No. Amen. The men said, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Say it was Eve that ate of that fruit. Amen. She was the first one. Oh, but the Bible says in verse number 7 of 1 Samuel 18, 7. And the women answered one another as they played and said, Saul has slain his thousands. Man, that's great. Amen. Saul has slain his thousands. And David, his 10,000s. Oh my. Getting under Saul's nerves now. Pride has set into that heart. And Saul was very wroth. And the sayings displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed unto David 10,000, and to me they have ascribed but thousands. And what can he have more but the kingdom? And the Bible says that Saul eyed David from that day forward. Amen. The awfulness of pride got a hold of King Saul, and he went from being one of the most humble men in all of Israel to becoming like a monster, to becoming like an animal, eyeing David, trying to kill him. We remember how he threw the javelin at him. We remember how he tried to hunt David down to destroy that lie. It all happened because the awfulness of pride got a hold of King Saul. He at one time was a humble man. He was at one time a man that leaned totally and completely upon God for victory. But then after some victory, he started taking the credit. He started getting lifted up, and it turned him into a monster. Can you say amen? God goes before destruction and the haughty spirit before a fall. And number 3 tonight, what does this have to do with me? Amen. What does this have to do with me? I'm no king. I'm no ruler. I'm just a simple man. I'm just a simple woman. I'm just a simple born-again believer. You see, I know that. But any time we act contrary to the Word of God, it is an act of pride. It says, God, I know more than you do. Your word says, be angry and sin not, but I'm going to be angry and I'm going to sin because I feel like. Come on now. Your word says to put you first, but I'm going to put you third because I've got things that I need to do. Come on now. See, pride says I can make it without the Bible. Many people say, there's a whole lot of Facebook religion around here. Amen. I don't mean around here, like here in this world, amen, whole lot of Facebook religion. What do you mean, Facebook religion? Let me explain what I'm saying. Don't misunderstand me. Facebook religion is sharing one post about the love of God, and I'm blessed, and I'm thankful for God, and then 5 minutes later using profanity. Come on. Well, that's right, brother. Amen. Amen. Oh, I got some people I had to block. Amen. Some people, I'm friends with them. I just unfollowed them. Amen. Got sick of seeing all that mess on there. Oh, but I'm telling you, you see, it all stems from pride. The Bible says that I'm to be holy. I'm to live holy. I'm to abide in Christ, and as long as I abide in Him, I'm going to bear that proper fruit, but I can bear fruit without abiding in Him. It's pride. Amen. We can't do anything without God. Pride says I can make it without the Word of God. Pride says I can make it without a proper prayer life. Amen. Pride says, I'll just get up behind this pulpit and I'll just preach. I've been too busy to pray. You know what that is? That's pride. Pride says, I don't need to pray. I've been serving God 20 or 30 years. That's pride. Oh, I'm telling you, church, pride. It says I can make it without a proper prayer life. Pride says I can make it without church. Amen. Pride says I don't need the house of God. I can make it just fine on my own. It all stems from one thing called pride. Pride says I can make it without the Holy Ghost. Amen. I don't need the Holy Ghost. That's just for those that are crazy. That's just for those that are extreme. What it is it's pride. Can you say amen? Everything God has for me, I want it. Can you say amen tonight? Oh, yes, church, pride. I know of a few Christians. And no, I'm not talking about anyone here. Amen. So don't start looking. Amen. I know of a few Christians, though, that think that they know more than anyone else. Y'all saying amen now. Don't let your minds wander. Oh, but I know of a few Christians in that way. They know more than anyone else on the face of the earth. I knew one person in particular. They said, I don't need a pastor. They said, Jesus is my pastor. I said, you're just unteachable. That's what you are. Amen. Why were they unteachable? It's because they thought that they could do no wrong. They know more than you. They know more than me. They know more than that church. Than that church. It all stems from pride. If a man thinks himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. No one else. Amen. They're unteachable because of pride. You know, pride hinders people from being able to really be used by God. Amen. Oh, I'm telling you, pride, it's an evil and an awful thing. Can you say amen? Amen. Galatians 6:3, once again, if a man thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Outside of a relationship, hear me now, outside of a relationship, with Jesus Christ, all you and I are sinners on our way to a place called hell. Amen. That should do something to us. Without Jesus, all we are sinners on our way to hell. But that's why He came. Amen. That I don't got to go to that awful place called hell. Amen. That I don't have to be lifted up in pride. Amen. That I can just totally lean and depend upon God. Amen. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, for by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Amen. I have done nothing on my own to be proud about. I've done nothing on my own to be proud about. But the things I am proud about are just the things that God has done in my life. Amen. Is that you tonight? Amen. Say, Lord, help me not to be lifted up in pride. But may the only things I boast in is upon what you've done in my life. Amen. Without God, I wouldn't be here tonight, church. Amen. I'd be a wicked man. My mind would be so twisted. Corrupted. But it was God. Amen. Only God. Hallelujah. Sometimes as a pastor, I think, Lord, there's a lot of other people that I can imagine that you could really use. God, I know who I used to be. But thank God for the blood. Amen. Thank God for the blood. Let's just lift up our hands right now. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood that was shed upon Calvary's cross. God, we have nothing to boast in our own. God, it's in you that we boast, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's nothing I've done that I can be proud of, but I am proud of what God has done in my family. Amen. I said amen. I'm proud of what God has done in this church. Amen. You better believe it. I'm proud. I'm proud of what God's done in you. Amen. Amen. I'm proud of what God's done in you. Amen. You know, I boast about you a lot. Not in a bad way, but in a good way. Amen. You know, Sister Mary, my mom, she was saying a while back, she said, yeah, we're going to be having a ladies' conference, and, you know, just thinking about who to have a speaker. You know what I said? And I don't want you to hate me and kill me. You know what I said, though? I said, I know a lady that can really bring it. It's anointed. Come on. Yeah, you just try to get brownie points now, brother. He earned his kiss. Amen. Oh, but I was bragging about the Lord. Amen. Oh, I was talking to someone about Sister Marlene here recently. I was boasting about the Lord. What God's done in her. And through her. Can you say amen? Oh, bragging about. Oh, yesterday, Sister Diane, my grandma was here, and I said, Grandma, I want you to help me pray for a piano player. And you know what Grandma did? She said, Son, I'm going to come in agreement. Sister Diane said, Pastor, I'm going to agree in that too. Praise the Lord. You know what happened? I told my grandma, I said, Grandma, guess what? I said, Wayne and Diane started coming to this church right when it very first opened. I said, they went to Lamont Church for years and years until they turned it into a Spanish church. And I said, then my grandma knew all these people that they knew and this and that. And you know what? My grandma said, those just sound like some good people. I said, you're right, Grandma. I said, they just don't make them like that anymore. Amen. Oh, but I'm telling you, I'm proud about what God has done. Amen. I never knew Sister Melrose before she was saved, but I've heard a little bit of story. Not gossip, but story. But I'm telling you, I'm proud of what God's done in you, sir. I'm proud of what God's done in you. I'm proud of what God's done in me. It's nothing new. Amen. Let's all stand to our feet tonight. Amen. Brother Randy, would you come to that piano tonight? Hallelujah. Let's just worship God, church. Hallelujah. Shalabaka kanabashike debo shandabaka. God, we're nothing on our own, Lord. God, if it wasn't for your grace, Lord, I wouldn't be here tonight, God. I know I'd have been dead. I know that, God. Oh, God, but your grace, it wouldn't let that happen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Shikarabaha kalabusandabaha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We're nothing without Christ, church. And God forbid we ever get to that place where we say, wow, look what I've done. Look what I've done. Amen. I'm proud of him too. Amen. Oh, praise God. You know, I was talking with someone here recently, and they said, one thing about your church that I love, they said, it's the size of it. They said, I feel loved when I go there. They said, people are just real. Amen. No fakes allowed. Amen. She said they're just real down-to-earth people that love God. They said, my church used to be like that. I had no idea. They said it used to be real small. They said, but it's really grown. It's a huge church. They said, but now it's totally different than the way it used to be. You see, growing is great, but whenever we grow, we can't allow a spirit of pride to say, I remember when it was this size, and now it's this size. Amen. It's pride. God cares nothing, absolutely nothing about how many people are here or how many people aren't here. God just cares about whether the people that do come are here to worship Him, to praise Him, to hear about Him. Can you say amen? Oh, I'm telling you, pride goes before destruction, but a haughty spirit before a fall. Don't let the awfulness of pride get a hold of your heart. Amen. Let's all find a place to pray tonight. Amen. Father, I love you. I praise you, Lord. I thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your spirit.
Welcome, Holy Spirit.
Oh, God.
We are in your presence.
May we realize that we are nothing without you.
Fill us with your power.
God, I have nothing to boast on in my own self. You made all things possible. Thank you for my family.
Welcome home.
Thank you for my children, Lord. You gave them to me. You blessed me.
We are in your
you blessed me, Lord, with my family, with my church family.
Fill us with
they are every good gift that has come from above. Fill I thank you for every single person within this house, Lord. Oh, God, I thank you for my wife, Lord. What a gift. What a gift, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. God, thank you for this gift, Lord. God, just touch my sister.
Take complete control.
Thank you. Thank you for these gifts. Thank you for these gifts, oh God. Oh God, these precious gifts.
We are in your
God, we're nothing. We're nothing without you, God. Hallelujah. It's in you, God, that we boast. Oh God, hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. It was you that healed us. It was you that saved us, Lord. Oh God, in you we boast tonight.
We are in your presence. Fill us with your power. Live inside of me. You're the living one.
Praise God. Amen. It's just like, like a football player, you know. They get up there after the games, and some of them say, "Oh, I'm just the man, you know. I'm just a bad dude, you know. That's why we won." But then there's other guys, and some of them will get up there and they'll just say, "Oh, I just like to thank the Lord. Now let me tell you about what I did tonight, you know. But then there's, I don't know if you watched Alabama. Who was it? Was it Alabama and Georgia? The national championship game. Nobody watched it?
No.
Never mind. There was this, Alabama's regular, the senior quarter, his junior quarterback. He got pulled from the game because he just wasn't playing good. And the coach pulled him. And next thing you know, they get this other guy off of the bench, and he comes in at the second half, and he catches Alabama back up. And after the game, Alabama won, this guy that he led his team back in the game. After the game, they asked the guy, they said, "Man, tell us how you did it." And the guy just looked so humble. He said, "First of all," he said, "my family isn't going to like this." He said, "but I must thank my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ." He said, "He's the one that made this possible tonight." He said, "I'm nothing without him." I thought, I hate Alabama now, but I kind of like this guy. Amen. Should have played it, or should have tried to go to USC. Amen. Then he'd have really been blessed. Amen. Oh, but I'm telling you, he didn't want to be lifted up in pride. Amen. I just thought, praise the Lord. Amen. And I don't want to be lifted up. Amen. Hey, you're being lifted up in pride. You trying to steal the show. Yeah.
Yeah, Kate is liking to steal the show now.
Yeah, I guess it's true.